1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 7 through 8, the Amplified Classical Edition. The Amplified Classic Edition. And it should be on the screen behind me, but verse 7, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 7, reads like this. Love bears up. Can you read that? Is that up there?
Yeah.
Okay, read that with me now. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes. Is ever ready to believe the best of every person. It hopes, are faithless under all circumstances, and it endures everything without weakening. Verse 8, love never fails. Can we say verse 8 again? Love
never fails.
Can we say that real loud one last time?
Love
never fails. High five your neighbor on both sides on your way down and tell them love never fails. Love never fails. Love is a winner. I said love. How many of y'all like winners? How many of y'all like being on the winning team? I don't know about y'all. I like being on the winning team. You can go ahead and take your seat. I like being on the winning team. And listen, if you're on love's team, you're on the winning team. Because the Bible says love never fails. Man, I already feel the presence of God in here today. So we are continuing in our series, LoveShift. Say that with me. LoveShift. The power to save the family. Say that again. LoveShift.
Love
the power to save the family. And specifically today, we are going to be talking about how to win with love. Watch this, even when it hurts. How many of y'all know love hurts sometimes? Yeah. And if you never felt it, you ought to try it. Love hurts. Love hurts. And I said sometimes, a lot of times. A lot of times, if you're loving right, if you're really loving, love hurts. But it's a good thing. Somebody say it's all good.
It's all good.
Anything of value and worth is going to cost you something. I'm gonna say that again because you can take that into the corporate sector. You can take that into the boardroom. You can take that wherever you work, right into your office complex on Monday. Anything of worth and value is going to cost you something. I want you to personalize that. Make it personal. Say, it's going to cost me something.
It's going to cost me something.
Yeah. It's going to cost me something. Robert and Kayla, they were telling me that he had gotten promoted during training camp. They had moved him up. In order to move up, though, it cost you something. It cost you something. It cost you something. Say, it's going to cost me something. It amazes me how people, they want stuff and then don't want to pay for it.
Wow.
You ever went through Walmart Supercenter checkout line and got up there and just smiled at them? And they gave you your groceries and said, be on your merry way. Has anybody ever had that experience? Because if you have, I'm going to start going shopping with you. That's never happened to me. When I got up there, I had to pull out a debit card, credit card, something. They don't care how you pay for it as long as it's credible and valid. All right? As long as they're going to be able to get their money from it. And so whatever is of value and worth will, everybody say will. It will cost you something. You're going to have to sacrifice something. Just a point of review what we've been over the last couple of weeks. We said that love is designed to bring a thing into its potential. Love is designed to bring a thing into its divine potential. Now, let me say this. Without love, a thing cannot come into its potential. Y'all mind if I come down here with y'all? I just like being close to the audience. Without love, you can't come into your divine potential. Say that with me. Without love.
Without love.
You can't come into your divine potential.
You can't come into your divine potential.
You have divine potential. You can't see it. That's why we call it potential. It's in you. That's more to you than what meets the eye. Yeah. It's potential. God gave every man, woman, boy, and girl in here potential. And you can't come into the fullest of your divine potential, the fullest of God's purpose and intent for your life, if you don't love authentically. Say, I got to love authentically.
I have to love authentically.
Yeah. If you operate outside of love, everything you're associated with, everything you attach to, cannot come into its potential. Your marriage, your relationship with your friends, your relationship with your family. Everything that God says, that thing has potential. And wherever there's not, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Wherever there is not love, do you know when there's an absence of love? Do you know what's spoken into your heart? That thing that God gave potential, what's now spoken into your heart about that very thing, whether it's your marriage or whether it's some relationship you have with a family member or with a friend. What the enemy speaks into your heart is that thing is without potential. Because love is absent. Wherever there's love, you see potential. Wherever there's absence of love, you see no potential. Amen? What is love? Agapeo love. Agapeo love. The love of God. When we talk about agapeo love, we're talking about the love of God. Love that originates from God. It is unconditional love that seeks the well-being of another. Say unconditional love. That what? Seeks the well-being of another. Listen, whether or not you get it back in return. Now that's a major caveat, isn't it? Whether or not I get it back in return. That's what agapeo love is. Agapeo love is love that seeks the well-being of another, whether or not I get it back in return. It's not conditional. It's not love that comes with conditions. God's love does not come with conditions. If you do this, I'll love you. That's not what God says. God says, watch this, I love you. That's all God says. He says, I love you. It doesn't come with conditions. I wish we could do that. Look at your neighbor and say, I love you. No, I'm talking about tell them, y'all. Tell them. And don't really even expect them to say anything back. Well, of course they're going to say it back because they're going to repeat the same thing to you. But look at them and tell them as if it didn't even matter if they said anything back. Just tell them simply, I love you. Yeah, I love you. I love you. All right, now some of you husbands and wives, now y'all have a hard time with that. I'm just picking on you. We said there are multiple forms of love. There's phileo love. There's brotherly love. Brotherly love. You heard of Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. There's brotherly love, but this love, it's important, but it doesn't heal. It doesn't transform. It doesn't change. It doesn't bring about change. Brotherly love. It doesn't save. Somebody said it doesn't save.
It doesn't save.
And then we talked about eros, erotic. That's where we get our word erotic. It's sexual kind of love. That love's important too. That love's very, very important. But listen, it doesn't save. It doesn't heal. Well, what's his name? Marvin Gaye wrote something about that. Well, he did, you know. It doesn't heal. It doesn't heal what really needs to be healed. All right. Things that matter. Somebody say things that matter.
Things that matter.
Make you feel like you're getting healed, but it doesn't heal. But then we have agapeo. Somebody say agapeo.
Agapeo
is the love of God. Agapeo love, listen, agapeo love is not just love God provides. It is the love of who?
God.
It's God himself. Somebody says it's God's love.
God's love.
Yeah, matter of fact, you can't agapeo anybody unless you get it from God. Somebody say it got to come from God. It's got to come from God. And so, this is what we've been talking about over the last couple of weeks about this love shift. We need to go from these other forms of love and putting all of our primary focus into just phileo and into just eros and basing our relationships off of these love forms of love. And we need to begin focusing on the love of God. Say our focus should be on the love of God. Because that's what saves you all. That's what heals. That's what changes. That's what truly transforms people's lives. Can I hear back from you on that? Glory to God. Come on, put your hands together if you agree with that. Hallelujah. And it is possible. We said last week, it's possible to love like God. It's possible. You can't say, I can love like God.
I can love like God.
Yes, you can. Why? Because you're hardwired for it. You're hardwired for it. Anybody ever read this book, Eat Right For Your Blood Type? Okay, well, I read it. It's a real thick book, and I read it through and through because I wanted to know how to live longer, Miss Unreal. I wanted to know how to live an optimal life. Somebody say optimal life.
Optimal
Yeah, and when you do things according to how you've been typed by God, it helps you to partake of optimal living. When you do things the way you've been typed, according to the way you've been typed, you've been God typed. Say, I've been God typed.
I've been God typed.
Your blood type is a part of your being God typed. He gave you a specific blood type. My specific blood type is B positive. It's B positive. Well, optimal food for my blood type is fish. I love fish, by the way. I ate some fish last night. I love fish. I can eat fish every night. I don't know if that's healthy for you, but I love fish. And why do I love fish so much? Because of how my body responds to it when I eat. You see, when you engage into the way you've been typed, your body begins to respond appropriately. Somebody say, according to the way I've been typed.
According to the way I've been typed.
How have I been typed by God? I've been typed to love. And when I engage in how I've been typed, listen, I begin to live optimally. So if you engage outside of the way you've been typed, listen, if I eat ice cream all the time, that's not optimal for my blood type. Or bread, carbohydrates, that's not, probably not optimal for most of y'all blood types. But I love it anyway, glory to God. Don't be playing me like I'm wrong now. Isn't it somehow we love stuff that's not optimal for us?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We lack the feeling of getting the last word when somebody done got us. Oh no, I can't let you have the last word, sister. I got to get you back. Oh no, brother. You ain't gonna walk away and think you done got the best of me. I'm gonna cut you up. I'm getting ready to cut you up. And that makes you feel good, don't it? Yeah, it does, but it's not optimal for you. It's not optimal for you. It breaks you down physically. It breaks you down emotionally. It breaks you down mentally. It breaks the home down. Where there's friction in the home and everything's on, everybody's walking around on eggshells, even the cat is tiptoeing through the house. It's not optimal living. Somebody say optimal living. What am I trying to tell you? God commanded us to love because he wants us to live the abundant, optimal life, you all. Hallelujah. How many of y'all want to live the optimal life? Abundant life. Life where I got peace and joy. And most of us men, we just want some peace. You can have all the big nice stuff and all the nice frilly decorations that I like, you know, that our wives like. But a brother do anything for some peace, ain't that right, brother? I just want some peace. If I can have some peace in my home, I'm good. I'll do anything for some peace. Alright? Well, God says if you want to live that kind of life, if you want to engage in that kind of life, you need to love. How does that look? Love your neighbor, Jesus said in Matthew 22, as yourself. Glory to God. Boy, that's so good to me. Watch this. We've been hardwired to love. Say that I have been hardwired to love. Therefore, it's easy. Say that. Therefore, it's easy. For me to love like God. It's not easy to your flesh. That's why you gotta sacrifice your flesh. You gotta kill your flesh. You gotta die to your flesh. Because it's not easy to love like God in your flesh. Why? Because love hurts. Look at your neighbor on both sides and tell them love really hurts. Come on. Love hurts. Love, you all, is always a winning strategy, but sometimes it looks and it even feels like I'm losing. Sometimes love makes you look like you're losing. I know I've been in that position where I've had the love. I had someone on the phone, and my wife, boy, you know, you know, she's holy and she loves Jesus until you mess with her husband. And then you mess with her husband, she turns into the Incredible Hulk. She goes from David Banner all the way to the Incredible Hulk. And this was back in the early days of our ministry campus in Arkansas. And this person was disenfranchised. Let me say it that way. They were dis, disenfranchised with something that I had done, and they thought they were going to let me know about it, and so they called the office one day, and they were just letting me have it on the phone. Well, they was letting me have it, so anyway, thank God we were on the phone, because that was back in my early pastoring days. I wasn't as mature as I am now. Yeah. But anyway, they just let me have it. I was just, you know, it had to be the Lord, because, you know, back in my younger days, I was real quick-tempered. So it had to be the Lord. I was just sitting there. I was taking it. And my wife, she was sitting across from my desk, and she was hearing every word they were saying, and she was like, "Hey, but she did say, "Hang the phone up." Because she was getting, you wasn't getting mad, you were mad. And but this person, if I saw this person, which I still do whenever I go back to Northwest Arkansas, if I go in Lowe's, I'm going to see this one particular person. And because I chose to love them like God loves, who am I talking to in here? Because I chose to love, not because I chose not to get in my flesh. I could have gotten, it's real easy to get in your flesh, but I chose not to get in my flesh. I chose to love because it's my position to love. It's not just my position as a pastor, it's yours too.
Right.
Say, it's my position to love. And because I chose to love, I can stand and have a conversation with this person in Lowe's. We laugh and talk. I'm asking them how the children doing. They're all off in college. I'm asking how's the wife, how's all this good stuff. And listen, because when you operate and engage in the love of God, man, you can live an optimal life. And I won't say free of stress and free of duress, but it'll be less and less of what you have to endure. Sometimes we bring problem and trouble on ourselves.
Yes.
Say love hurts.
Love hurts.
But love always wins. I don't want you to lose that. I don't want you to lose that. Love always wins. If you love, and even if it looks like you're losing, you really win. Okay. Right. Lord, help somebody get that right there. I said, if you love, it may look like you're losing, but you really win. You're winning. Because love always wins. The Bible says it. It's not my words. Love, say that with me. Love never fails. So this is why. This is why people choose not to engage in love. Because it hurts too bad. Miss Now, this is why they choose not to do it like Jesus. You know, you remember we used to wear the wristbands?
Yes.
What would Jesus do? WWJD, baby. And those bands just went away like an old trend and fad, didn't they? Because it wasn't nothing but a band.
Yeah.
It wasn't in our heart.
Right. Right.
What would Jesus do? We didn't care nothing about what Jesus do. Somebody make me mad, I'm gonna tell you. Take the band off and wear it in your heart. Always ask yourself the question, what would Jesus do, so love can prevail?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Boy, since I've been preaching this series, I've had more opportunities. It's just like my wife has been super getting on my nerves lately. Super. I'm not talking about she's done anything wrong. I'm just talking about me. I'm talking about me. It's not going to have anything to do with her. It's me. It's my test.
Yes.
My spiritual father told me years ago, she has her test, you have your test. I'm helping married couples out now. Stop taking each other's test.
Oh, wow.
Amen.
We get in trouble when we try to take each other's test. And so I stopped trying to take her test, and she, when she sees me going through a test, she just stands back and pray. Because it's my test. It's my test. I got to pass my test. Ain't no cheaters in the kingdom of God. And so, man, I've had some tests since I've been ministering on this series. I've had some tests. I'm talking about she say the slightest thing and it just, boom, I jump on 9. I'm not talking about in my response to her. I'm just talking about in my heart. See, sometimes before the response comes out, you've already got a fight going on in your heart.
Yeah.
I'm helping somebody right now. And so I've had to get through these tests in my heart. And so I had to establish in my heart, you got to establish in your heart that you're going to do it like Jesus right off the bat. If you don't establish that up front, when you get in the midst of tests, you're going to lose. Somebody said, love always wins.
Love always wins.
But it hurts.
But it hurts.
Yeah. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6. I want to read that in God's Word translation, and they will put it on the screen so you can read it. It says this: the Lord disciplines everyone he loves. The Lord disciplines. Everybody say disciplines.
Discipline.
The King James translation says the Lord chastens. Chasten. When you think of that word chasten, it gives off the connotation of someone being whipped or spanked or punished. Chasten. The Lord chastens those that he loves. The Lord punishes. As a matter of fact, God's Word translation says, he severely disciplines everyone he accepts as his child. He severely did. We live in such a society. We have this misnomer about parenting. We think parenting is being friends. But very rarely do I get to be my. I want to be Miss Unreal, but very rarely do I get to be their friends. Very rarely do I get to be their friends.
Not yet.
Not quite yet. Not quite yet. Because I still got some discipline. I'm in the disciplining stages. Somebody say, God's a good father.
God's a good father.
And so if I try to be a good father and I understand that I still got some discipline to do, he's much, much better father than I am. God is over us, his children. And so how many of you know, all the more so, he's going to discipline more than you as a good parent. He disciplines those that he loves. If he loves you, you're going to see some discipline. Why? Because he loves seeing you hurt? No. As a matter of fact, we're going to actually get to this. It's probably hurting him more than it's hurting you. I just sure enough thought my mother was lying whenever she said that. I said, there is no way. Bro, I would say to myself about my mother, I would never tell that to her face, but I would say, there's no way you can be hurting worse than I'm hurting. There's absolutely no way. Because I'm hurting pretty bad. And do you know she swears, of course I'm running rabbits now, do you know she swears she never whipped me? I said, in what lifetime? I'm guessing you know my mother. I'm like, what planet were you living on? Love hurts. It hurts to be disciplined by the Father.
Yes.
It hurts, glory to God, to want to get the last word in and the Father comes and say, shut up. It hurts. It hurts. It hurts when you do something that you know that you should not have done, and then the Father comes and he disciplines you in his word. He may discipline you in his word while the man or woman of God is talking, while you're listening to a CD right in your car. You may be listening to a worship song and the lyrics are ministering to your heart, and it tells you, you know you were wrong with what you said last night. You know you were wrong. That's the Father's discipline. Somebody say, he only does it because he loves us. Come on, say that. He only does it because he loves us. That's the only reason why the Father disciplines. You better thank God. As a matter of fact, let's just take a praise break for discipline, for the Father's discipline right now. Let's put our hands together and thank God for his discipline. You better thank God he disciplines you. I said, you better thank God he disciplines you. Matter of fact, I'm grateful. I'm so grateful he disciplined me so that I don't go make the same asinine mistake that I made the last time. Thank God, because what discipline is supposed to accomplish in your life, it's supposed to give you a consequence to attach to an action.
Yes.
Without the consequence, you'll continue to repeat the same action over and over again. But if I have a consequence, unless I'm just stupid or crazy or something, I'm not going to do that anymore. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, I'm going to think about the consequence when I want to do that. Somebody said that's discipline.
That's discipline.
He disciplines those that he loves. It's just like my coaches. You know, we'd be out there stretching in 102 degree heat in August. And they walking around. You know, they making sure, you know, they got the nerve to come lean on your back with all their weight. Push you all the way down. Stretch! And you just cussing and saying everything underneath your breath. But they weren't doing it because they hated us. They was doing it because they cared about us. Because you get out there and you're not always stretched, you're going to hurt yourself. You think love hurts. Ooh, that's a revelation right there. You think love hurts. Without the Father's discipline, you're going to be hurting even more.
Yes, that's right.
My next slide, Sinai. Love blesses those who curse you. Love blesses those who curse you. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 44, Jesus preached this in what's called the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount. God's Word translation says this, but I tell you this, love your enemies. Love who? Come on, y'all come back to me. Love who? Love who? Lord, have mercy. Can you tell me what your neighbor just said, Miss Andrea? I mean, Miss Andrea. Love your enemies. Bridget, what did you just hear Miss Niall just say? Miss Niall, what did you just hear Bridget just say? Okay, now can y'all repeat what those three ladies just said? Love your
enemies.
Did we really just say that?
Said it.
Did we really just say that? You mean to tell me I gotta love my enemy? You mean to tell me I gotta love that person even if they come spit in my face? Glory to God. Lord, be with me on that day. Love your enemy. Not get even. We need that preached more today in this world than we ever did.
Yes.
If I was in Arkansas, I would stand up on this chair so I could really get your attention. Love your enemies. Love those who persecute you. That's what the Bible says right here. That's what it says here in the King James translation. It says, but I say to you, love your enemies. Bless curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Lord, did y'all see that? And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Pray for them. We got the perfect example. Jesus Christ said he was hanging on the cross and he was praying for the people that were persecuting him. What did he say, Pastor? He said, Father, forgive them. Because they don't know what they're doing. Anybody ever stopped in the middle of an argument or after an argument with somebody, a heated discussion you just had? Anybody ever stopped and just said, Father, forgive them, and knowing that they were in the wrong? Instead of, Lord, I call fire down on them right now. I pray, Father, that they die soon as they walk out that door. Or maybe you're not that harsh, but maybe you're like, Lord, let them get measles or the mumps or something. I want them to be incredibly discomfortable the rest of this week. But do you stop and say, Lord, forgive me? Me and my wife, we have this habit. We forgive each other before we ask. I'm not saying it's not important to ask. I'm saying go ahead and release it even if they don't get it. Am I helping somebody this morning?
Yeah,
go ahead and release it even if they don't get it, Miss Henry. You don't have to come and apologize to me. I'm going to forgive you if you do or you don't. That's love. That's agapeo love. Whether or not you come and tell me I'm sorry, I was messed up, my attitude was jacked up, I'm sorry, I had a bad morning, I woke up on the wrong side of bed. Regardless if you do that or not, I'm going to release forgiveness in my my heart, because that's the love of God. How do you know that, Pastor? While we were yet sinners, he what? Died for us. Whew. Boy, that takes me somewhere. Because maybe some of you all, y'all probably been good in two shoes most of your life. I have not been. I have not been. You want to learn more about it, you got to go to a men's encounter. I'll tell you some more about it. I can't tell you on Sunday morning, but I can tell you those encounters. And we got one coming up in October for all you men, October 28th. And you hear just how messed up Pastor used to be. But I believe that's why God uses messed up people. Because you heard me quote the scripture earlier about those who have been forgiven much, love much. I'm going to say that again. I want y'all to say it with me. Come on. Those who have been forgiven much, love much. And listen, don't ever get too far away from how much you have been forgiven. Because if you ever allow yourself to get too far away from that, somebody get on your nerves, you won't understand that you have been forgiven. But who are you to withhold forgiveness from them? So that's why me and my wife, we forgive regardless if she comes and say, I'm sorry, or if I come and say, I'm sorry. And when she comes and when I come, you know what the response always is? I already forgave you. But thank you for saying it. Is that blessing anybody?
Amen.
Say, love blesses those.
Love blesses.
Blesses. Here, let me give you a theology class, just a real little quick sectional here. Bless, that word bless means enable to prosper. So when I love someone with the love of God, when I release forgiveness, when I love like God loves us unconditionally, what I'm doing, watch this, I'm enabling that person to go about their business and prosper in life. And guess what? I'm also doing it for myself. I'm positioning myself to live the optimal life. Because I'm loving like God. Say, loving like God.
Loving like God.
Positions me.
To live the optimal life.
Love sacrifices. Love sacrifices. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're almost done. Love sacrifices. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 talks about it. It talks about what love does. In the Amplified Classic edition, it says in verse 5, love is not conceited. It's not arrogant and inflated with pride. It's not rude. It's not unmannerly. It does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights. This is sacrifice. You know, when I think about that, I think about a soldier. Did we ever get that picture manipulated? Sinai, no, we didn't. I want you to go there. I want you to make a mental picture in your mind. I wasn't able to get the picture up for you, but it was a picture of a soldier who was seated in a chair. He was an amputee with two of his what do you call these prosthetics? With two of his prosthetics. This, to me, was a picture of ultimate sacrifice. He had his soldier uniform on. He looked proud. He took that picture proudly. He didn't look like he had any embarrassment on his face. He proudly served his country and gave of himself for people that probably don't even love him back. Do you see that? Do you have that picture that I just described? I want you to get that imprinted on the backdrop of your mind. Because that's what sacrifice looks like. It's the giving of yourself for somebody else. It's the giving of yourself, watch this, for the well-being of somebody else. You know, there are people there, they sacrifice, and they don't want me to say this. Many people do it, and they don't need attention brought to them, but I'm going to bring attention to them because I got the floor. I'm going to bring attention to these people this morning. Our dream team, I want you to put your hands together for the people that come early in the morning and they set up to make sure all of this is right by the time you get here on Sunday morning. Now, I want you to do it with a lot of appreciation because they don't have to do it. We don't pay them to do it. We ask them to do it. We don't pay them to do it. We ask them to consider doing it. Why? Do it for them? No, they're not doing it for themselves. They're doing for people who are going to show up, who have a need. They got a real need. They're coming to find Jesus, glory to God. They're coming to experience the love of God. And listen, we were just coaching them this morning in our dream team rally, and we said, you got to keep the why before you. You got to keep the why before you. Here's the why. Because people are in need of Jesus Christ and his love and his sacrifice that he paid for them on Calvary. And God the Father is madly in love with them and he wants more souls. And the only way we're going to win more souls if we continue to do this in a sacrificial manner with love. Somebody say, with love.
With love.
And so I applaud you, dream team. Hospitality, parking lot, production team. Don't even really need to get a chance to enjoy service because they got to be back there on production, making sure every little I is dotted, every little T is crossed, and Bridget's over here. She's recording to make sure we get on FaceTime, Facebook Live, and all these good stuff so others can partake of the service outside of this service. And man, I'm telling you, you ought to see the operation back in Arkansas right before service. People like scattering like little ants, they're getting all this done. And I thank God, I'm going to take time. Thank God for Arkansas, y'all. And a tear's about to come to my eyes because they gave up their pastor. When I shared a vision with them, that God had placed a big vision in my heart to go and reach others with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I want to do this beyond Arkansas. And so would you give your pastor up? Let me put a campus pastor here and let our ministry go and reach others that need the love and restoration of the kingdom of God. And they sent us here to let you experience restoration. Can you appreciate Arkansas? Come on, I'm looking right now. I thank you, Northwest Arkansas. I thank you, Restoration Church, Northwest Arkansas, because you selflessly gave. I said last Sunday, Restoration Church, Northwest Arkansas alone has given with the gifts that have been given even by individual members of that church, aside from the $10,000 gift that they gave to send us here. They've given together about $20,000 for this ministry here. They don't even know you. They don't know your faces from sand. But they say, we know one thing. You've been preaching love to us for 19 years. And so we know that the love of God constrains us. Somebody say, God's love constrains me. See, if you're not constrained by the love of God, you will live any old kind of way. You will do any old kind of thing. You will say any old kind of thing that comes to your mind if the love of God don't constrain you. See, you have to be constrained by a higher power. You have to be, there's a family, do you know there's a family that just moved here from Arkansas? Just because they love Charlotte and they want better for their children, but they moved here to Charlotte from Northwest Arkansas, and this blew my mind when me and my wife asked them, why are y'all coming here? They said, because we want to come help. And they're sitting here this morning. Wave at everybody, Tim. Yeah. Wave at everybody, Bernard, okay? Valerie. And her husband, Vincent, he's driving that moving van right now as we speak. Because I want to help. I don't know who I'm coming to help, but all I know is I've been taught about love. And love is about sacrifice. Love is about giving up myself for the well-being of another. Is anybody getting what I'm saying this morning?
Yes.
I say, is anybody getting what I'm saying this morning?
Yes. Yes.
Love is about the well-being of another.
Yes.
It's about sacrifice. It's that picture of that amputee soldier who gave of himself for the freedoms that we get to enjoy on a daily basis.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to close with this. I close with this. I wouldn't dare let you lead without giving you a strategy for winning. And I want to read this out of the Message Bible Translation. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'm going to read this out of the Message Bible Translation. I love how the Message Bible reads. I'm going to give you three things as a part of our winning strategy, how to win with love even when it hurts. Somebody say, love hurts. But I can still win with it. Yeah, love hurts, but you can still win. You can still win with it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, in verse 13, it reads like this. But for right now, until that completeness, until we are made complete and whole by Jesus Christ, when we see him, at the consummation, when we see him, we have three things to do. Somebody say, we have three things to do. I want everybody to say that with me. We have three things to do. Yeah, see, you're talking to yourself. We have three things to do until we are made perfect. Now, you know we'll never be perfect in this earth, correct? Because flesh won't allow us to be. But we'll be made perfect when we go see God, right? That's when we'll be made perfect. But until then, say until then.
Until then.
You got three things to do. Here are those three things. Trust steady in God. Can you put that slide up there for me? Number one, you just got three things to do this now. It's not hard. Can you look at your neighbor and tell them this is not hard? It's just three things. We just got three things to do until we're made perfect. Number one, trust steadily in God. Trust steadily in who?
In God.
Trust steadily in who?
God.
That means don't try to love in your flesh. Don't try to love in your own ability. Don't try to do what I'm talking about in your own ability, because it hurts. It's hard. It looks like I'm losing. And in my flesh, I can't do it. But watch this. With God, we can do, you said, all things through Christ who strengthens us. Trust steady in God. Listen. You know what steadily means? Steady means I'm just on an even keel, right? I'm not getting too super excited, but I'm not all the way down. I'm just steady. Trust steady in God. That means daily. If you're taking notes, write that down. It means daily trusting him for what I need. Trust steadily in God. Trust him daily. See, I believe this will help us love better if we daily trust God for what we need. I really do believe this will help us love better. It won't be as difficult to love others who don't love us back. Trust steadily in God. Trust daily him for what you need. Because if we do that, when I don't get what I feel like I need from that, I feel like Miss Unreal is supposed to be giving me. I'm picking on Miss Unreal up. Whole lot this morning. If I don't give what I feel like she should be giving me, guess what? It's okay. It's really good. Because it's not Miss Unreal that I'm trusting. I'm daily trusting him for what I need. Somebody say, trust God.
Trust God.
For what you need.
For what you need.
Ooh, somebody ought to be jumping for joy off of that. Trust God daily for what you need. Number two. Unswerving. You know what it means not to swerve? You know, drunk people swerve, right? People who are intoxicated, they swerve up all over the place. They don't just swerve driving, they swerve walking. I've seen drunk people turn just a big old circle in the middle of the floor because they've lost all of their alertness. All of their balance. And so it says, do what unswervingly?
Hope
unswervingly. That means never
lose your ability to see good in everything. Never lose your ability to see good, to see what God can bring out of it. Now let me help you. Let me help you because I don't want to be misunderstood. And I'm getting ready to end with this last one. I'm not trying to communicate that you should stay in a bad situation where you're being abused physically or verbally. I'm not saying you should stay in a bad situation and continue to put up with it. That's the love of God. No, that's the love. That's not the love of God. That's craziness. God gives us wisdom. So you can continue to love afar from being abused. Get out from where there is abuse. Leave from there. Go to a safe place where you're not going to be abused anymore. But continue to see hope, to hope for the best. Even if what looks like the best is not going to come out of their relationship, continue to hope that God's going to bring about what the devil meant for bad. He's going to bring the best out of that situation for you. Is that good? Come on, put your hands together if you receive that. And then lastly, I leave you with this. Love extravagantly. Love extravagantly. Love extravagantly. You know what that simply means? Love intentional. On purpose. That's what this 30-day love shift is all about. And once you're through writing, you can go ahead and stand to your feet because we're finished. That's what this 30-day love shift challenge is all about. If you don't know about the 30-day love shift challenge, I want you to go to our website, www.therestorationplacechurch.org, or I want you to go to our Facebook page, The Restoration Place Church Facebook page. You'll find all about the 30-day love challenge. What are we doing in the 30-day love challenge? We're doing three things on a daily basis. Number one, we are reading 1 Corinthians. We're reading and meditating. Thank you, Bridget. On 1 Corinthians. We just got through reading 1 Corinthians. I call it the love chapter. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're reading that through daily. If we're married, we're going to do what? Read it with our spouse. We're going to read it together. Number two, what are we going to do? We're going to pray for somebody else other than ourselves. Number three, we're going to do something kind for somebody else. Maybe a family member. Maybe your natural family. Maybe your church family. Do something nice for somebody on your way out by smiling at them and telling them, have a blessed week. That's kind. That's being kind. Smile at somebody. Somebody may need that smile. Buy somebody lunch. Take them to lunch. Don't just you and your family go to lunch. Me and my wife, we're taking somebody to lunch today. We've already invited them. We invited them before we came to church. Because the only way to love, turn it up a little bit, Drew, the only way to love is to love like Jesus loved. Oh, Lord. And the Bible says, John 3:16, we all, most of us know it, for God